I hope our previous speaker probably woke you up after lunch. It's very difficult to stay awake past lunch. I have that all the time. Okay, my name is Murli. I'm with Manipal Global Education, and each of our panelists here will introduce themselves. This session is about a very critical subject, topic in practically every discipline. This is the interface between academia and industry. This sort of an issue probably did not exist 200 years ago, maybe even 100 years ago, when in practices like design or any other practice, any other craft, the way you got in was you apprenticed yourself with a master, learned on the job, and then became proficient and productive. Somewhere along the way, the Industrial Revolution happened, and then the technologies and the knowledge required became very complex, and so there was the need to have a separate school set up to learn the craft before you could be prepared to actually start producing. In India, we have another problem. The Industrial Revolution didn't begin in India. In other countries where the Industrial Revolution began, those who actually tinkered around and designed actually produced the Wright brothers. They were bicycle mechanics. They built airplanes. And so with Daimler-Benz, for instance, they tinkered around with engines and built cars. That didn't happen. The Industrial Revolution was helicoptered into India. We started initially importing products, and after that, we started building products to specs that were developed elsewhere. The last couple of decades, industry in India has become more and more sensitive to developing design sensibilities, and lots of design schools have come up. Nevertheless, there appears to be a disconnect between academia and industry, or real or perceived, and that's what the discussion here is going to be about, and how we can bridge that disconnect between the two. So we will start with our first panelist. You have a phone here. Please introduce yourself and present your views. Also, your name, your affiliation, and whether you're going to present the academic perspective or the industry perspective.
Yeah. Hi. I'm Samir from UX Designs. From, of course, the industry perspective. Couple of thoughts I have. One of the major things with academia that I have seen in India, and I have not been to a design school in India, but in the US, that the practicality aspect is missing. How to practically do user experience design or any design work, that aspect is missing completely. I mean, I have seen now people coming up for internships for 3 months, 6 months, and learning from the industry. But people who have even master's degrees in design probably don't even know how to do user research. What are the fundamentals of research? How to do sampling? You know, those things. Simple things, right, that we would expect at least from a master's student. But they know the entire process very well, thoroughly. And they have been taught to, you know, kind of take that process ahead. You know, blue sky thinking, do research. But industry doesn't work that way. Everyone knows that research is pretty expensive. And it really depends on the time and budget the project and client has. You cannot always go to 30 users and 40 users. But you can do some discounted usability, or testing, or some kind of research. So I think the practicality aspect is missing from the academia, is my viewpoint.
Okay, can you speak to how you think it might be, one might approach addressing it? Just take a minute, no more than that.
Yeah, absolutely. I think academicians can add a lot of value to the industry, the way you see in other maybe European countries, that a lot of cutting-edge research actually happens in the academic world, in universities, with the help of the industry. I think if we can set up that kind of platform, because in academics, they would have the resources, the student resources, at least, and industry has other kinds of resources. But when industry in their own world, they keep on doing things and projects, hardly get extra resources from the management to work on something that is cutting edge and extra. So I think if that fusion happens between industry and academia, to progressively do some kind of research in the experience or design field that could be consumed then by, you know, the industry. That would be one of the things that I would suggest.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
Hello, good afternoon. I'm Naveen Bagalkot from Sisti School of Art, Design and Technology. And as the name suggests, I represent academia. It's a hard word to pronounce, academia. Tongue twister, especially after lunch. Anyway, I kind of continue with what he stopped at. So yes, cutting edge research. And I agree that that's where we need to collaborate. And so my position is that that there are two ways that academia could actually contribute to industry in India, design academia, to design industry and any industry that is involved in services and products. One is, of course, that we need, academia could offer a very rich human resources as trained professionals, and we are not doing a good job of it. That's a point well taken. I've been here for the past 2 years in the space of academia, and I agree that we are not really doing a very good job of it. The second question that we could actually contribute is to cutting-edge research. In my very brief experience of industry, I left industry and ran away from industry within 9-10 months, is that industry, it's very hard for industry to look beyond the next year, at least at the design level. It happens at the very top level, if it happens. There are hardly any industry that I know that look 5 years down the lane. In a very serious way, not just a marketing campaign. But academia does that. I work in the profession of HCI and interaction design, and we have been publishing. And for the past 2 years, my lab in Sisti, we have been focusing on a definite problem space called as home healthcare, and how do you enhance that? And looking at self-monitoring technologies. And we have created enough interesting knowledge that I think would be very helpful for industry when they're not looking for this immediate product line, but how will healthcare happen in 5 years down the lane, right? Or 4 years, 5 years down the lane. So that's, I think, is very interesting, and we would like to, and I would be very happy to work on with the industry at that level.
Thank you.
Hello. Hello.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm Keyur. I come from IIT Guwahati, and as the name indicates, I would represent academia side of the story. So I'm a bit positive about the industry-academia relationship based on the experience what we have. So there has been a lot of talk about the industry-academia relationship in various conferences, and I've been panelist on those as well. So I'll not be talking about what kind of problems exist, but let's take a step ahead.
Oh, okay. This is sort of, yeah, anyway.
So let's take a step ahead about what can be done next. So let me just cite one example what we are doing, and maybe that will add a good overview about the problems that they are both sides are facing. So we have just started a project with Nokia. Okay. Yeah, so yeah, I think now this is fine. So yeah, just again, I'm Keyur from IIT Guwahati, whoever didn't know. But so I was talking about, let's take a step ahead about industry and academia relationship. So I was citing an example of the recent collaboration that we have done with Nokia. Interestingly, the collaboration was collaboration happened for the first time in India with Nokia Global Patenting Department. And when we asked about that, how come this is the first time it's happening in India? So they said that academia is very rigid in terms of giving IPs and other logistics to the industry. However, the same situation happens much better in China, where they have much better collaborations with universities and professors around them. So that's one side of the story when it comes to industry problems with respect to IT and other logistics. At least I can talk about the IITs and all. The grass is not greener on the other side as well. As a professor, I would certainly want, I have joined as a professor to have much more knowledge than what perhaps industry could give it to me, in terms of research, in terms of activities related to HCI, wearable computing, and so on. Perhaps that approach, when industry would look from an academia and look from a collaboration in terms of co-publishing the papers, publishing patents together rather than just having a complete IP-based, IP-based collaboration. If that publication research knowledge and that approach has been taken, then perhaps both sides would really take the discussion much ahead. But somehow we have been doing very good collaborations with the industry, considering all the big research labs in the country and the world. So I'm very positive about the kind of research collaborations what we are having right now. And it's been working out with us, with Microsoft, IBM, and other research labs, publishing joint papers in ACM and IEEE, as well as publishing patents as well. So somehow I represent the better side of the collaborations that we have.
Can we move on, and then we'll come back later. Dominic?
Hello. Yeah, my name is Dominique. You probably noticed I don't look like a localite. I'm actually imported from abroad. And I enjoy my stay here in India now for 3 years. And I am in a bit delicate situation because I consider myself neither academia or industrialist now, or in industry now, because I had a feet in both parts. I've started actually to take the role of director of the ISD school with the within the DSK group in Pune since last June. And I think the reasons why actually I would have a positive opinion about industry and education collaboration is because actually the ISD is a school that has built up since 1987 a very specific relationship with the industry, as we are actually not having any academics in our university teaching. So you need just to know that I'm talking about 1987 because it's a school that's been found in France and which has been creating a collaboration with the DS Kulkarni group in Pune. And I would say that actually I don't see a gap between the industry and the academia. If I look at the experience I have made before joining ISD and after joining ISD, I fully agree, though, that there are a lot of areas where we have to work together. And probably what we are trying to assess and what is the area where we have to work the most on is actually that instead of talking, we have to do. So basically, I think that the gap the industry might actually feel, and I fully agree with that, is that many students understand the process, but if they don't have a process to follow, they are lost. So basically, when I'm saying that what we would like to develop and what we are developing since 1987 is actually a policy where students learn how to make and learn to offer solutions. So I think that I would give the microphone to somebody else because otherwise we're running out of time.
Good.
But basically, thank you.
My name is Atul Manohar, and I manage the UX team at Informatica India. The first time when I read this, the title itself, Industry plus Academia Fusion, a very funny incident came to my mind. A couple of years back, there was a movie. I don't know how many of you would have watched this Hollywood movie. So this particular thing is aliens versus predators. And interestingly, at the end of the whole movie, obviously aliens and predators fight, they die, and only the humans kind of survive, you know. So, I'm sorry for diversion, but interestingly, are we really talking about huge creatures called industry and academia, some kind of monsters? Actually, no. We are talking about needs of people, needs of human beings, because I remember I was a student, I was an aspiring job seeking. I'm a beginner also. I have been a bit of a manager. I love going and teaching. So actually, somebody like Dominique would have probably wore all the four hats till about today, right? So interestingly, in terms of just saying that what industry wants and what academia wants, how about talking about what students want from their life, you know? Do they want money? Are they ready to work for money? Or are they inspired more from something else? I remember I was running a small startup in Pune 10 years back, and almost every year I used to have two students come to me, work with me, practically without pay. So they were ready to work for me without pay because they knew that they'll learn. So is that attitude still there in the students? Have we really seen that attitude? I don't know. I'm not saying today's students are good, bad. If somebody is working for money, that's a good thing. I consider that to be a very good thing. So if somebody comes and says, okay, you're offering a job, what kind of salary are you offering? I don't take that as an offense. I like that because people should work for money. Nothing wrong in that. But I think we should just try and understand the people's perspective, you know. What teachers want? Are the teachers interested in coming over to the industry and probably working for a month? Are the employees interested in going to the institute and maybe teaching for about a month or 6 months? And I think much easier the we'll be able to understand each other's perspectives, you know?
Okay.
Hi, my name is Satish Patil and I'm from Tata Elxsi. I take care of UX and research group at Tata Elxsi. I always wonder about when we talk of industry and academia, these two things. One is speed and second is inertia or acceleration of change. So for example, industry need, particularly if you're talking of UX as a domain, have been changing pretty rapidly. The kind of technologies that are getting deployed in the product is having massive impact on manifestation of UX. And if you look at academic institutes, you know, it's more about inertia, it's more about history of academics, and as they say, knowledge is permanent. So it's about, at some instance, if I can say, difference in inertia between the rate at which industry forges ahead and the way academics, says, if I can put it, try and map the industry needs. So maybe it's worthwhile to ponder on how do you bridge these gaps.
Okay, my name is Priyanka. I come from Symbiosis Institute of Design. And my, of course, I represent academia for now. And my take on all that has been said would be largely to agree with most of the people who say that there needs to be more collaboration between academia and industry at a proper place and time. At the same time, I think there is no dearth of collaboration when it comes to UX, because the field itself is, the name itself is less than 19 years old. And so there are neither enough practitioners in industry or in academia for the subject. So, and most of the, at least a lot of private schools function in collaboration with industry. So a lot of collaboration does happen. However, I would agree to one of the, another panelist who had said it before, was that not only we have to be resource providers and we can work on excelling at that as well. It's not that we are doing excellent job at that, and there is a long way to go there as well. But at the same time, we need to collaborate way more for knowledge creation. So some institutes would have collaboration with industry, some institutes do not have. I think I would like to use this platform to say that most all industries should collaborate with as many institutes, educational institutes as possible. And lastly, since the topic of this, I think the forum, the conference was also a focus on customer experience. I think that is sort of a natural progression for user experience. So I think, and there are no institutes offering any kind of knowledge on that, at least in India. So we may like to collaborate and design a new course also, because in industry there's a huge dearth of courses or knowledge related to academia.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, after this first initial expression of your sentiments on this issue, let me throw out one thing. What is one practical move, either from industry or academia, that you can suggest that could bring, if there's any gap, what could bridge that? What is one very specific, very practical move? It could be an initiative, it could be an activity, it could be whatever it is. Any of you could pick up. Yes, go ahead first.
If I can put it this way, a very structured periodic review, maybe it's a bi-yearly or once in a 3 year, academic curriculums to see how best do they map industry needs.
Okay, very good. Yes.
Let me just add a bit to that. I think education is kind of all about experiencing. And if at all, just a crazy kind of a proposal wherein If I get to, yesterday there was a very interesting talk. It was about empathy. So if at all, I can, instead of talking about the students, come on, they don't do this, they don't do this, the teachers don't know how to teach. Instead of that, if a professional comes up, stands up and says, I'm ready to take six days of training as a student, you know, in your institute. Or I may volunteer to come over, and if at all you think I'm worth it, I volunteer to teach for 1 week. And vice versa, you know. And vice versa, the students also come over and try and experience the kind of work environment that we are living in. To your point, actually, on the roadmap for 5 years, very few companies have the luxury to think beyond a quarter, you know, unfortunately. So we are all running between the quarters, though theoretically there is a roadmap for 10 years, 5 years, and so on, but still we have to kind of match that run rate of the quarter and end our quarter rightly. So instead of planning for 5 years, how about experiencing small bits of each other's life? I think that will make our life much easier.
Okay. You wanted to say something?
Yeah.
And then did you want?
Okay. So I'll just put it in one word. That would be co-knowledge creation.
Co-knowledge creation. Yeah. Can you elaborate?
Whether this could be in form of taking combined courses together or having sponsored research projects.
Uh-huh.
And it will also help in terms of getting good students from a hiring perspective, but mainly from a perspective of co-knowledge creation, I would really want to put in that.
Oh, yeah. After that, Dominique. Yes.
I would continue on similar lines, but I'll be a bit more idealistic. My wet dream for an industry academia fusion is a lab that's already exists in Sweden. It's called as Mobile Life, if you're not heard of it. It's a lab that is actually managed by the Stockholm University, but it's an autonomous lab. It's funded by the government of Sweden and also by corporations like Ericsson, IKEA, and other Scandinavian companies. And what they do is cutting-edge research concepts that most likely, and also, you know, a lot of knowledge about human behaviors with technology. And a lot of it actually would come in the next 2 to 3 years. Well, so they are targeting the big things about the next 4 or 5 years down the lane, but the way the lab works is people from industry go and work there. The professors from Stockholm University work there, the students work there, so it's a pool of talent working on a very particular problem, right? So this calls, again, for a challenge for the Indian industry, and this I'm not really sure that we can address this, is can the industry, Indian industry, come out of their IP protection and invest in a lab where open innovation happens, and nobody's really sure of where that knowledge will go?
Okay.
This is an open question.
Thank you. Dominique?
Well, I would say that at the end, it's all about money, in the sense that to a certain extent, maybe one of the gaps that you have between the industry and the educational system is that actually the industry feels the gap because they actually don't pay for the service, between brackets. So let me explain you what I mean. At the moment, what is happening in many countries is that you have a shift from public education to private education, which, even though I represent private education, is actually something that is a big challenge. At the end, the industry is our client, if you look at it on a broad perspective. So the industry is already doing some efforts, actually. We hope that they will do more efforts, but actually the trend in the industry is definitely the fact that they come to see institutions because they have noticed that there are some issues with performance and with capability of the students that come on the market. And they tell us, okay, we would like to invest man hours, or we would like to invest project time, or we would like to invest even financially into your group, because we have recognized, and I think this is very positive actually, so I think that the gap is actually reduced progressively, because we have recognized actually that what we get from you might not necessarily be what we need. So as I said before, we are actually working on policies that help students to become makers, but there is still a gap, because obviously to have a good result, you need real collaboration. But ultimately, I think that if the industry really wants academia to correspond what they want, we have to question if it is really the fact that the industry has to define what the students will be. Of course, the students have to be performant. The students have actually to answer questions, have to be able to get the return on investment that their salary means to the company. But if we have a collaboration, maybe we are going to be able to create something that is in the middle. Because on one side, academia says, we do what we think is okay. The industry says, no, you don't, because basically you create unemployable people, and we have to start everything from zero. What I think is actually that if the academia and the industry work together, then they will be able to form, and I don't like to use the word form, because basically it means that we're putting people in molds and we definitely shouldn't do that, that we can help. I would use the word groom, maybe that's better in the context. People who are actually understanding what we want, but they understand as well, but we understand as well what they are. So that would be my first point. But ultimately what I think has to happen as governments tend worldwide to consider education as something useless, because then people become more stupid and they control people better. At the end what happens is that the private institutions would need support from the industry, and I would even say industry has to finance private institutions or educational institutions generally 100%, because they're the ultimately beneficiaries of that. And that is my point, because basically, if the industry would finance education 100%, because the government doesn't do anything anyway, then we would be able to create a kind of ecosystem that actually would be beneficiary for the whole society.
Okay. Ramnik, we'll come back to that. Okay, Samir, you wanted to?
Yeah, just one practical thing, right?
Yeah.
I would suggest an exchange program. Managers from industry going and teaching for 3 months, and the professors coming and managing projects.
Samir, that was really wonderful. So as a baby step in that, what we did a few months back was, we had a research project wherein IIT Bombay IDC student and his guide was actually working with a couple of guys from my team to work on a kind of a research come project. So there are certain challenges we have seen. On the industry side, we were it was very difficult, because for our kind of a domain is slightly complex to understand, and for a newcomer it becomes almost 2 to 3 months of job to immerse into that and stuff like that, but that's okay. On the other side, institute side, they had a very fixed structure in which their projects could fit in, you know. So it didn't work as internships, because that institute didn't have 6 months of internship. So they had something called projects, sponsored projects. So we kind of converted that sponsored project into really a research project, which was internally treated as an internship. So you know what I'm saying? So these three adjustments are very much possible across. So I can just call my HR and say, by the way, he's an intern coming with me for 6 months. And in reality, we are doing a research for the institute. We are doing actually a kind of a sponsored project. So it just, there are the channels, I believe, are very much there. It's just the matter of the willingness and coming forward one step and saying, okay, I have got a research project. Are you game?
Coming forward on the part of industry or academia?
Coming forward on both the sides, because from the industry side, frankly, offering an internship project for about 6 months is, trust me, a lot of investment. So I've got only 10 people team, and one of my guys will be guiding this person for 6 months. A lot of babysitting over there. And a lot of investment. So that's a kind of a commitment from the industry, as well as academia should kind of trust me, saying that, okay, he'll learn actually in the industry. So that's the kind of trust I believe I'm talking about.
Did you have one last thing to say? Okay, we'll do it after that. I'll just seed a couple of questions, then we'll open up questions to the audience. Okay, so if you can just be brief. Yes. Did you have one thing to say? Okay. I realize that.
I just have one point. So we have been doing this. So professors from our institute, they actually go on a sabbatical at various research organizations, and they work for a year or so. And similarly, researchers from the organization, they come to the institute and then work for a long time.
So that exists. Okay. Yeah. You're saying. Okay. So one issue is, on the one hand, we see that it's already happening, and in some other places. So is one issue seems to be that information doesn't seem to flow easily around. There are some information barriers that seem to exist. So maybe there needs to be more coordination within academia and industry so that these opportunities, these experiments that are being conducted elsewhere are known across. Okay, go ahead, Dominique.
So actually, I think that I see a gap because you talked about the industrial revolution. Mm-hmm. And this hasn't happened here, obviously. And you've talked about helicoptering technology into the country. So India is not the only country where this has happened. It happened in many other places at different decades. You have China, you have Japan, Korea. And actually, one gap that you could notice, and that can be the origin of this debate, is actually that design education is focusing, and design, the understanding of design is focusing primarily on the IT industry. I don't know how many people here represent the manufacturing industry, but basically the gap is that the approach of designing for the IT industry and the approach for designing for manufacturing is a totally different thing. And there I think that actually the frustration of the industry can come, because basically designing for the IT industry is something that is less challenging, and don't understand me wrong, than designing for the manufacturing industry, for one very simple reason. The IT industry design principle is trial and error. And if you make a wrong code, it's not a problem, you'd write a new one. If you are designing for the industry and you are designing for the manufacturing industry, trial and error doesn't work, because otherwise maybe the brakes on your car don't work or the airplane falls down. So actually, I would say that the biggest challenge maybe that we could consider is that as the industry, the manufacturing industry in India is still relatively young, the educational institutes haven't maybe not enough experience to actually work with the manufacturing environment. And there actually I would say that we need to insist more on one side the readiness of the manufacturing industry to heavily invest into education, because you cannot learn craftsmanship. That is something you cannot teach craftsmanship in the sense that it is not a process. It is actually a maturing process. So I would suggest as well that eventually in the future we try to understand how we can get these energies together in order to close this gap.
Okay. Okay. Yeah.
Interestingly, on your point, frankly, I am seeing a lot of positive synergy already. On a personal basis, I have experienced most of the institutes personally coming to me or people around here saying that, would you like to be on a panel of maybe the external examiner, or would you like to come over and probably take up a workshop in our industry, in our institute. Mm-hmm. And I believe most of the institutes have a designated person. I don't know what is the designation, but these guys are actually doing a great job. I mean, I personally have been contacted at least by 3 to 4 institutes till date, okay, which is a good sign.
Okay. Yeah.
So I will just reiterate what some of the panel members already said. So when it comes to placement or when it comes to internships, we have absolutely no dearth of industries approaching us. And we have an overflow. We have to say no. And you know, we are at a fix. How many, what do we do with so much of requirements? However, when it comes to knowledge creation, I don't see many volunteers.
By knowledge creation, do you mean research?
By research or, yes, projects which would create in the end create some sort of knowledge. It could be a live project, it could be a hypothetical project.
So this is not forthcoming from industry, is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Okay. All right.
30 seconds.
Yes.
Sorry.
Go ahead. No, that's fine.
I think it's a valid point, and I thought I'd just bring out here, you know, to the institute Navin represents Srishti. In fact, we did some similar initiatives wherein in our discussions with, you know, their faculty member, it came out that they were striving, they were dying for, you know, giving industry-relevant problems to their student. So that, you know, they can get a better, say, relevant education imparted to it. And in some sense, we work together with them to literally try and define their assignments, their project, and, you know, try and have as good as a dry run of what they would practice in the industry. So it's no more about academic projects or hypothetical projects that they are dealing with in their curriculum.
Okay. So last, and then we'll.
Yeah, sure. So to your.
Yeah, we'll come back later anyway.
Yeah. Huh? So to your point of information exchange.
Yes.
That really depends on, I think, the culture of that institute, whether it's an IIT or a private institute. Because I can vouch for IIT Guwahati, we have not met, but people from IIT Guwahati come all the way and work with us for 6 months, and we are also writing papers with them. We've just written 2 papers right now. So it really depends on the culture. This seems to be one progressive institute. There are a couple in Mumbai that I can vouch for. They have started business design courses back in 2003, and they come and they, you know, involve industry. So culture is again an important aspect.
Okay. All right. So let me throw in something. Dominique made an interesting observation. Whether there's a perception or there's data for it, I don't know, but it's interesting nevertheless, that much of design is focused on the IT industry. Now, let's assume this is indeed correct. The fact is, the IT industry exploded in the last 20 years, and most of the customers were overseas, and they were demanding, and it's possible that the need for design was emphasized there, because the Indian market had gotten used to accepting whatever the industry gave them, because you had no choice. There was no competition, so people were resigned to getting, whereas the market overseas, there were free markets, and hence the IT industry especially needed design sensibilities. Now, of course, we have a new generation coming up, a lot of young people here, who demand a good design, and perhaps there will be a shift in the local market, and therefore it will not be just IT, but other areas. What I'd like to ask of you is, some years ago we heard, whether or not they actually did it or not, in China they started 100 design schools. I mean, everybody was talking about it. Now, we haven't seen an iPhone coming out of China yet, even though they've set up so many design institutions.
They come from China.
Well, they come, but we know where they come from. We know. We're talking about design here. Now, can India hope to set up and produce world-class design? And if so, what does it take? What will it take? What kind of collaboration between academia and industry would it take to make that happen? To say India is where you come to for design. You want to start? Okay, he'll start and then Dominique. Okay,
that's a great one.
Yeah.
Interestingly, to the best of my knowledge, quite a few institutes are at this moment still struggling for a number of teachers.
Uh-huh.
I could be wrong, I'm sorry. So that's precisely where, if at all, we have right now about 10 design schools in India, and all the 10 design schools probably are still looking for good teachers around, if I'm not wrong.
Mm-hmm.
If at all, there are about 2,000 more schools in India, design schools.
Mm-hmm.
Would there be enough teachers? Probably no. There are two reasons, let's face it. Is it something to do with the kind of returns the teachers get versus the professionals? Probably, but that's relatively fixable. Actually, do people really want to go and teach is where industry could actually contribute. So if at all there is a kind of a model wherein there is one institute which has only 10 fixed teachers, I don't know whether it exists, and their real need of the number of teachers is 30, say,
okay,
and they have 10 on their payroll, and the rest of the 20 are actually coming out of industries. So they have 20 industries lined up who are contributing one week each or something like that. And trust me, 1 week in my kind of an industry is an expensive affair. They're actually running between the two quarters, and you know what I mean saying, right? So I'm investing 1 week of one of the resources of mine. It means a lot of investment. But actually industry would probably come forward and do that.
Okay, very good. Dominique?
Yeah, I would agree with you, actually. We face exactly the problem. So we hire people, actually, at the moment, because we face exactly the same difficulty. We face even one more difficulty, because we actually want to hire industry professionalists and not academia. So we don't discriminate academia, but basically this is the policy of our institute. But to go back to the to what you said, indeed, it is a heavy investment for the industry to send someone to participate in academics, because of the fact that that there is no justifiable return on investment. And this is our biggest challenge, actually, because when I meet the industry partners that we're working with, they are ready to provide us man hours, but their question is, what is going to be my return? And that is something that is actually very difficult to answer. But one of the answers can be, basically, that the return is somebody who is directly employable, that will have the right attitude at work, and who will actually be able to understand how the industry works. Because I think that actually, even if you have a very good designer who has not been involved in industry doesn't understand how the industry works. And we have had presentations today about actually how the design awareness or the design maturity is evolving in companies. And I see that there you have a big gap as well. The other thing I would like to say is that talking about the fact that we might not have enough teachers if we have more design schools, it is obviously going to be the case. But to solve that, there is probably a much bigger step to be done before, which starts actually before the education that is taking care of design education. I think that, to a certain extent, society would need to change. Because one of the challenges we face is actually that anything that is related to design or anything that is related to innovation requires people to have learned actually to think differently. So we are getting to a problem that is probably much, much deeper, because basically the educational system that is prior to design or whatever education is a system that doesn't encourage creativity but encourages only data absorption. So actually we have, as educational institutes, a double challenge. First of all, we need, of course, to understand what the industry wants, and we're working on that. But on the other hand, we need to help the students that come to our institutions to actually get out of the scheme they have been going through for 12 or 15 or 20 years, where they were told, okay, you learn this book by heart and you recite it perfectly and you get 10, to a thing where they would need to be helped to understand, read the book and analyze it, and then tell us your thoughts and what you would do differently based on that.
Right. Thanks. Yeah, go ahead. Levy?
I somehow feel that we are trying to catch up with China or play catch up. Mm. I was reading a tweet today, and somebody was tweeting that while we are still talking about, at the Prime Minister level, talking about come make in India, China is already talking about design in China. Right. So one thing, I think it's not a really fruitful game to play catch up with China because of the numbers. I mean, I don't think so we should be really focusing on opening up 2,000 or whatever number of design schools in India. Mm-hmm. Because we have a problem of quality first. We should address that. And that comes back to Dominic's point. And I agree that, but also I really think that it's very hard for design schools to address this problem of lack of creative thinking. It's much more core. It's not at a skill level, but it's a level of thinking that has a child has developed already because of the schooling system. If at all we need to change, produce a lot of good, high-quality designers, then we need to address the K-12 system.
So we have to start from the roots.
Yes.
Very good. Anybody else? Any other thoughts on this? Yes.
There is a dearth of professors. Mm-hmm. There is also a dearth of designers. So it's a game of supply and demand. And the demand is always going to be driven through industry. So that's my point number one. Okay. The point number two is, I think you asked about good design from India, mm-hmm. right? It's possible. Mm-hmm. And it is being done already. Mm-hmm. Just that the information flow is such that people don't know about it. Okay. And quality is a big issue. I think it's, to make a statement, it's probably in the culture of the Chalta Hai things. Name one global product by any $5 billion+ Indian company. Zero. It's that culture.
Okay.
That's a problem.
Okay. I just have a
very quick, because yeah. we need to go to the.
Yeah, I think it's an open thing anyway.
Yeah.
I just realized that when he's talking about the industry drives the demand, I just felt that we really are narrowing it down, because I just remember that, hey, we have a lot of social entrepreneurs coming up. There are a lot of startup companies coming up which really don't think themselves as industries, right? There are more enterprises, more corporations, and maybe, and this is very speculative, maybe we should also start thinking about them and what role design plays, if at all, in these organizations. But maybe this is a sidestepping.
No, this is okay.
I think I'd like to add to this thing, because I think there is also the topic which you have not touched is that many in industry believe that catering to industry requirements is sort of the end and final intent of the institute, which a lot of academicians believe is not. It could be creating new knowledge. It could be creating new design entrepreneurs. It is not only resource providing. So I think a lot of mismatch happens there also when the benchmark seems to be whether you're fitting into the industry standards or you're good enough or not. A lot of academicians would believe that the benchmarks are different.
Okay. Very good. I mean, it's all a debate between training and education. Are we just a trade school that train people, or do we generate knowledge? We can come back, but we want to give an opportunity to the audience. If any of you have any issues you want to raise or any question, please do so. We can, and if there's none, we can always come back and add stuff. And yeah, if you would like to address it to anybody, you can do that, or to a specific person, you could do that too.
Hello.
You can number them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 if you don't remember the names.
So thank you, UXINDIA, for giving the industry an interface to the academics. I have an ask from the academics out here. So I lead a team of about 20, 25 people, and I have actually kept my team a little non-designer centric. So I really encourage people from all kinds of backgrounds, you know, to come and work with us as UX designers, because I think it's all about problem solving. And if people genuinely want to solve problems, it doesn't matter if they have a design background or not. However, what would truly help is if the academician can come with, you know, some sort of short-term courses that help people think in a structured way. I think there's a big gap there, because we have just one or two institutes providing those kinds of short-term certificate courses, but not many more. So this is an ask from me.
So is it the case that our design institutions being focused on regular degree or diploma courses rather than short-term, and that is where the opportunity is? Is that the case? A microphone? We need a microphone. There, right there. Okay. Did you want, you were saying she was, can we just finish her sentence and then you can, yes, go ahead.
So I think you are Prachi, right? Yeah. So we have actually been thinking on these lines, because we have been getting such requests from a lot of people in industry, because there is, like I said, a huge dearth of courses and trainings, especially coming from an educational institutes. So I agree that is a long felt need, and it's high time that we sort of fill it. And in fact, most education institutes would agree to that. Okay.
Great, thanks. Dominique?
To briefly answer, I would like to separate two things. A brief course or a workshop is definitely something that is obviously required by the industry and is something that is very useful. But we should not forget that actually, like any discipline that you learn in life, one part that really helps you to understand what you're doing is time, because that makes you more mature. So I think that on one side you can have a dream, and the market is requiring for that, to have a quick learning process how to become more structured about, or how become a designer. But to a certain extent, structure in thinking is not only process related, but it's a growing process as well. So we have to be very prudent about trying to reduce the length of the apprenticeship, because actually it is as well time that helps you to mature.
Okay, thank you. Kio, do you want to say?
Yeah, so
try to keep it brief, and yeah, we can have a bunch of questions.
So in that context, I would want to reiterate the point what we mentioned about number of faculties we have in the institutes. So already we have courses on bachelor's, master's, PhD, and postdoctoral research. So the faculties are already so tied up that they perhaps are unable to float that. So that's a pretty just like logistics that at least the IITs are facing.
That's an excuse. You're not solving the problem.
No, but I'm giving you the real picture. So that's the okay. I'm giving you the real picture.
Yeah, but why should they care? All right, they have a need. Okay. Anybody else?
Yeah.
No, I sympathize with you. I've been in academia, but I, okay. Anybody else? Any other question? Okay, keep your question brief, and please keep your responses brief too. Yes, somebody, the person at the back.
Mind if I'll continue on this? 30 seconds, please.
Okay.
Okay. I mean, it was really interesting to hear out one ask, you know.
Yeah.
One challenge I've seen historically in the last few years is if maybe IIT Bombay comes up with something, it becomes IIT Bombay-owned stuff, you know.
Yeah.
If Informatica steps in and says, okay, I want 20 designers to work with me, it becomes Informatica-owned stuff. But where is Kaladhar? So interestingly, this is a great opportunity for UX India to stand up and say, we provide a platform wherein it's an auction, it's an eBay for research, you know, for that matter.
Great.
So industries can say that, okay, I've got a research project wherein I'll be needing two students, one teacher working with us for about 4 weeks. This is the brief. Any interested? Guys, please raise your hands. And on the portal, some of the institutes will probably bid for it. I don't know, just
Bapu,
stretching it too
an
far.
Idea here. Okay.
So just stretching it too far.
Yeah.
But actually, that's a great platform on which people could... Actually, it's a demand and supply, I rightly said. So if at all I have a demand of such a project, I'll post my demand. If there is a taker, they'll pick it up and say that, okay, it matches my requirements.
I bet by next year, some young person here would have set that up.
So okay. It's a great startup idea. Give me some stakes in the company. Thanks.
Good. Great. The person at the back, yes, that person.
Hello.
You have a mic close by? Okay, we'll ask the person who has a mic, and then by that time, we'll get a mic to you. Although whoever has a mic, please ask your question.
Yeah.
Yes.
Hello. As a senior design professional, I would like to know, as per the industry going on, I mean, it's rapidly changing as per the emerging technologies currently. So is it, as per the academic the courses that is syllabus is going on currently, that as per industry standards or industry oriented, if the syllabus is changed or something, if it is profitable or something like in industry, I mean, in the companies, there are something like mentoring kind of something like programs or events, if it is, that will be more profitable or advantageous, which one will be you guys think or throw some light that will be very advantageous?
Anybody?
Okay. Yeah, I didn't get the question.
Hold on, is the question
yeah,
the
can
industry?
Can you state the question in 10 words?
Simple form.
I mean to say, which one will be more profitable for the person who is entering into the design industry?
So what kind of workshop would be more useful for the trainee, person seeking a...
No. I mean to say, those who are in the industry, those something like if the technology is improving and new technology is coming on the board.
Yeah.
So those who are already worked in some of the couple of standards or couple of skill set. So that will be more profitable if the industry has mentors or something like initiate some programs. That will be more profitable for the design professionals. That will be advantageous for them.
Okay. So what you're giving a suggestion? Okay. Yeah. Suggestion taken. Thank you. Next person. Yes.
I think somebody said like a lot of us in industry focus on a quarters, right? Mm-hmm. And we have vision, like we have plans for 5 years and 10 years, which we hardly are on papers, right? Why don't you pass on your plans that are on papers to the academicia? Okay. Let academicia be ahead of the industry. But I think like, because what we are looking at is that something that can be done? Give your 10-year plans. My 3-year-old daughter learns to play a mobile game much faster than me. Can't the academy be advanced than the industry?
Anybody? Yes, go ahead. Yes, go ahead. No. Mike. Quick, very brief.
Okay.
It is.
Okay. Right. Okay. All of you agree? Just raise your hands, and we'll skip. Okay.
No. I'll bring you the third dimension here.
Yeah.
And I think government is doing a lot to that effect. It's not about industry and academia, for that matter. For example, in this Prime Minister's Technical Committee, they appointed Ram Durai, and there are senior industry professionals helping government. If I can put this way, constitutionalize some of these policies towards education, including design education.
Anybody else? Any other response?
The top level, we are talking about the policies. Let me try and delve into the person, you know, going back to my story of aliens.
Yeah.
So at the human beings level, when a student comes to the industry, what are the lacunas the industry finds it? So actually, there is a, I don't have any complaints, frankly, from the students who are working, who have worked with me traditionally. And industry poses a lot of challenges, a lot of constraints for every design project. And while a designer is actually in the studenthood, he doesn't have any constraints. And that's the way it should be. So I'm not imposing that all the institutes should jump in and say that, they please work like industry, you have these three constraints, you have budget constraints and stuff. It shouldn't be that way. So it should be very different, and industry should kind of accept that students coming out of the institute are not going to be kind of fully professional as such, which is perfectly fine. 3 months, they'll pick it up.
Okay, very good. Any other response? Okay, next, this lady right here. Yeah, just grab the...
I have the mic now.
Okay, he's a mic dude, okay. He who has the mic.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Okay, so my question is, so when I was a student, I had the same concern which I have now when I'm a professional, as a design professional. The question is, when I was a student, I did an internship and I was not allowed to present the content anywhere else, IP thing. Now when I am in a service industry, I cannot recruit any intern because I work for some other clients, IP thing. What do I do?
So is this the issue of law? Is it an issue of practice? Can what I is it? That? Yes.
Okay. And this is what I meant when I threw this challenge to the industry.
Yeah.
I honestly believe that there is a space that comes very early before a product comes into its life and its conception, where industry and academia and all other stakeholders can work in an open lab, open innovation space. And I think we need to work towards that. And that's the only way I think that we could solve the IP problems that we all human beings, as it talks about.
So how would you make this happen? Let's say, what is one thing that needs to be done? I mean, this is the goal. How do you get to it? Yes.
Yeah. So, okay, taking from my own experience, right? I've been working with our lab in this space on, you know, out of clinic healthcare. I'm sure there are many industries here who are working.
No, what do you do? Here's a step to be taken by.
That's what I'm saying. So, let's have a meet. Let's discuss and you know what are big problems that you're facing, and let's set it up, right?
Okay.
Give me two resources. I'll give you three resources. Let's work on 3 months, 4 months.
Okay. Can UX India be the forum where that begins?
Sure.
Okay. Could be. Very good. All right. Can we have this lady? Yes.
Okay. To start with, I have a question. On this panel, there's no student. At the end of the day, you're talking about students. You're talking about how they should be reacting in this situation.
Very good. So is that you have a question, I hope.
Yeah, I have. This is just to start with. So the next point I want to make here in terms of the conversations that we've been having between the industry and academia, there's one more person, that's the alumni. How many of these institutes actually engage alumni to create, say, some sort of mentorship? So that in that way, you're not being only a money-minded industry and you're not being only an academy-oriented institute, but you also have somebody in between who's more emotional about, say, the institute and teaching somebody. So that could be one more thing. Now, my question here is, don't you think the education system in a design school needs to be different from a management school, a law school, and a medical school? So it's actually not. Because when we are given assignments and we are giving, say, internships, the structure is so formed, it's so stringent, that when you go out to the industry and you want to learn something new, you don't. Because you've been told X, Y, Z is real. Anything beyond that is probably not a part of your curriculum. So I think that sort of openness is not there in the design institutes. And I'm saying this on...
Okay, this is a big question. Now whether this perception matches with the reality, or is this a perception? Is it real? What needs to be done? Go ahead, folks.
So regarding the alumni part, so... again,
no. Like let's focus on the yes, because I think that's the yeah.
Well, maybe you're in the wrong school. That's my first comment. Second comment is, actually, we've just heard from the industry that they need to learn how to think structurally, if I remember well. So maybe the issue you're talking about is because of the fact that structural thinking in the environment you're confronted to is not being applied to the right area. So that is what I would like to answer, because basically it is obvious and that students are asked to be creative, to think differently. But on the other hand, if they want to be heard, listened, and efficient in the industry, they have to learn how the industry works in order for them to be adopted by the industry, and we had actually a presentation about this. So I would say that it is a very subtle balance between being crazy and between being boring, okay? So maybe you need to go to another institute.
All right, anybody has a more practical suggestion?
Yeah, so I would like to take an opportunity over here with this question. What we both are trying to mention, me and Naveen, regarding the co-creation, co-knowledge part of it. So if industry comes together and a research lab is set up at an academic institution, perhaps the point what you're trying to make regarding the kind of freedom of work and the creativity that you can have while working is much more possible, because we both have been doing in our labs and it's really working out in terms of industry adding up industry perspective as well as academic and research perspective both.
Anyone, by the way, we're closing after this. Anybody has any last words, not just speaking to this or anything else regarding the academia-industry interface? Very briefly, do you have any words to share? Anything you wanted to say, you can say it now. You want to, go ahead.
Yeah, last comments taking from this point is we would actually want and look forward to design leaders in academia, especially in India, which I don't see right now.
Okay, thank you.
I agree. And and I don't think, I think to expect similar things from the industry would be not the right comment. But what I would say, rather than saying anything about the industry, what we expect, what I would say right now on the table, put on the table, that SISTI and SISTI Labs is open for any sort of discussion and collaboration and taking these discussions concretely forward. It could be 1 week that you people come and teach here, do a workshop with us, or we do something, or we do research, or we think about 5 years down the line. That's a very concrete way we could discuss any industry here.
Okay, great.
Let's do it.
Yes. I'm shocked.
actually, we need to keep a balance.
Okay.
I've seen a lot of such discussions bubble up and create a huge kind of a balloon, but very few of these discussions end into completely positive thoughts that I carry. So individually, everybody sitting in this room, if at all, could just close your eyes and say, if I am representing industry, okay, what I have to offer to the academia, and vice versa, I think then we have it.
Okay.
No, I think everybody is agreeing on that aspect, so I don't really want to add to it. I would rather respond to one of the student who felt so violated about not being part of debate. On the fact that why is it that teachers or processes are not allowing them to freely think, educate, and experiment. Slightly different perspective coming from the industry side. We discussed it offline. Many times the experiences students as they come out of industry are extremely opinionated. We discussed of students being mold versus moldable clay. I would rather have students, mutually within the academia and students, not having them come out extremely opinionated so that they are far susceptible, far better equipped to grasp what industry has to offer initially.
Thank you. Priyanka? You get the final word.
Okay. I will only summarize whatever I think the intent of this panel has been. I think both industry and academia need to understand each other's point of view and work for a third cause and not just for each other, which could be knowledge creation or projects for society. I think if both sides could come together.
Thank you very much. I hope there were some seeds planted from this discussion, and please carry on the discussions with these folks beyond this, beyond this session, beyond today, with everybody around, and hopefully when we meet again next year, we'd have solved all these problems.